This fifth Sunday of Easter, I'm happy to be able to welcome you to this morning's worship. It's a great day in the life of the church today as we celebrate the baptism of Evie, and we're so happy to have her family here today. Truly, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. When the new day of the Lord is established, what a joyful day that will be. God shall wipe away every tear.
There'll be peace and contentment evermore. There'll be peace and contentment evermore. Every heart, every voice on that day will rejoice. There'll be peace and contentment evermore.
Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for God will bring new life and hope to all on the day of God's coming.
And the way of the Lord will that day be revealed.
God will give water to the thirsting soul. God will pour God's abundant blessings on all the people. Our hymn of praise today is Where Charity and Love Prevail. The words will be posted up on the monitor for you, and you may stand as the quartet sings if you'd like. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we are grateful that you have called us together this day, drawing us from darkness to the glory of your light. May our spirits rejoice at the good news you have for us today. Open our hearts to your healing love, for we ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. And as the quartet sings the first verse of My Jesus, I Love Thee, I invite Evie and her family to come and join me at the baptismal font. Hey, Evie, if I get a little fogged up here, don't worry about that. We'll get this taken care of. Hey, sweetheart. My brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. Nate, Lori Lynn, on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, and family too, on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? Will you nurture Evie in Christ's holy church that by your teaching and example she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life. Okay, who gets to hold this one? Hey, Kayla, that's okay. That's okay. Are you ready, sweetheart? Oh, hi. How are you? You're so pretty. We'll put some water on your head, okay? Evelyn Opal Lingle, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. May the Holy Spirit work within you, Evie, that you may be a faithful servant and steward of God's love. She's gonna, Evie's got her own ritual to follow today. Evie, I'm so happy. You've brought so much joy to this church family and to your family today. And when I think about you being here today, I think about all the love that comes to this place where you are embraced into the family of God. I think about all the generations of love that God has poured upon your family to bring you to this place. Make me a promise, okay? Promise me that when God speaks to you, you'll always listen. Renee has a special song just for you this morning. Members of the household of God, I commend this little one to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase her faith, confirm her hope, and perfect her in love. Evie, we give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of First United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant to faithfully participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. And the God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Let's pray together the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Evie, I have your certificate here and a cross for you and for your family. Will you all welcome Evie to the family of God? And as Evie and her family return to their seats, the quartet will sing Baptized in Water. It's time for Wiggle Time as we sing Jesus Loves Me. Campers, it's good to see some of you here this morning, and I know that some of you are watching online. Good morning to you. I hope you're doing well and staying safe. Don't let your guard down. Just be safe, and we'll be fine. We'll be back together before long. Their scripture today talks about a man named Stephen. It's the same name that I have. He's spelled differently, but Stephen said he saw the heavens open and saw Jesus standing with God. Wow. Isn't that a sight? If you were here, you would tell me what God looks like. And if you were here this morning, you would tell me why Jesus looks like. Yesterday, I had a really wonderful treat. I got a text message and was invited over to the playground. Two of my little campers were at the playground yesterday playing, and I got to visit for a little while outside at the playground. And as they were playing, and as Mom and Dad and Uncle were helping them play on the play set, I began to think of the scripture this morning, or the scripture that we're using this morning about the heavens opening up and Stephen seeing God and seeing Jesus. And while I watched my little campers playing on the playset yesterday, I began to imagine seeing Jesus standing there with them. I didn't really see Jesus, but one thing I do know is that Jesus was there with them, protecting them, watching them, loving them, keeping a watchful eye over them. Wherever you may be today, Jesus is with you. I can promise you that. I don't know what Jesus looks like, but I know Jesus is there with you. Sometimes Jesus is there in the love or the laughter we share in family. Sometimes Jesus is there when families gather to celebrate a little one and coming into the family of God. Always, Jesus is there when we need him. He comes at the very exact perfect time, and he surrounds us with love and grace and strength and care. Stephen looked up and saw in a vision God, and he saw Jesus with God. Yesterday on the playground, I didn't really have a vision, but I was reminded that Jesus is with all of my church family. Jesus is with all of my campers. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for always being there with us. When things get busy, when things get out of control, when we become worried, when we become full of celebration, help us to know, O Lord, that you are always there with us, loving us, weeping with us, and laughing with us. Thank you, Jesus, for being with us always. Amen.
Hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. You the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Renee. A remote control here so I can change channels. You won't mind, will you? Is that better? Invite you this morning to hear these words from the 7th chapter of Acts, beginning with verse 55 through verse 60. But filled with the Holy Spirit, Stephen gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. But they covered their ears, and with a loud shout, all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And when he said this, he died. The word of God for God's people this day. Thanks be to God. Poor Bob. One moment he was enjoying a beautiful springtime walk looking for baby ducks along the river trail, and the next moment he was lying face down and bleeding. He was trying to get back up on his feet when a park ranger rushed to him with a towel and a first aid kit, and blotting the blood from Bob's face and making sure that Bob hadn't broken any bones. The ranger said, I noticed that when you tripped, you were looking out at the river instead of the path. What were you looking for anyway? When Bob told the park ranger that it was what he was looking for, she replied, well, sir, there are baby ducks all over the place this time of year. You can't miss them. How about from now on, keeping at least one eye on the sidewalk before you get another close-up view? Bob was okay, except for his severely bruised pride. The park ranger asked an especially important Easter question. An important question for all of us. What are you looking for anyway? The risen Christ asked Mary Magdalene almost the very same question on that first Easter morning. He said, "Who are you looking for?" Now, there's something we need to keep in mind. What we're looking for can determine what we see and don't see. Who we're looking for can determine who we see and don't see. Before sunrise on that first Easter morning, Mary Magdalene came to Jesus' tomb looking for and expecting to find the body of Jesus. When she only saw an empty tomb, she ran to Simon, Peter, and John and told them the facts as she saw them, adding her own reactions. Mary was convinced that someone had taken Jesus' body. So who knows what Simon, Peter, and John were thinking as they raced back to the tomb? Who would have stolen Jesus' body from the tomb? The Romans? Soldiers? Grave robbers? Some fanatics group? What or who were they looking for? Even after they found the empty tomb and the grave cloth still in their folds in the tomb, Mary Magdalene stayed outside, only looking into the tomb. Her vision was so unclear with tears from her weeping. What was she looking for? Well, she was looking for a body that needed final preparations, and certainly not the living Lord, would be my guess. What you're looking for really does influence what you actually see and don't see, even if it's right there in front of your face. Who you're looking for really does influence who you actually expect to see and who you don't expect to see, even if she or he is right there in front of you. Well, left on her own and in her deep grief, Mary may have seen only a stranger who she thought was the gardener. Yet it was the risen Christ who opened Mary's eyes and heart to see that he was the answer to her Easter question. It is the living Jesus Christ who opens our eyes and hearts to see that he holds the answers to our questions. What are you looking for? Who are you looking for? There's good news today, because whether you're here in person or worshiping in some other place, the living Lord is with you and the living Lord embraces you. Jesus, who is very near, knows the powerful hungers of your heart and still loves you. The risen Christ understands what you have done and left undone and still offers you grace and forgiveness. Today, the New Testament lesson proclaims yet another powerful response to the Easter question. Who we find is the risen Jesus as the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. Today, we look for the one who holds us in the divine palm. There's a song that's in our hymnal. It's entitled "On Eagle's Wings." Here's some of the lyrics. You who dwell in the shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow for life, say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock, in whom I trust. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under his wings, your refuge, his faithfulness, your shield. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. And who we find is the risen Christ reigning with God. Today, the good news is that the risen Christ continues to embrace us into the family of God. Our daily lives can spin out of control in an instant. Well, remember Bob in the sidewalk? Sometimes it seems like it takes all our efforts and energy simply to avoid a total collapse into chaos. Still, the risen Christ reminds us that he will cover us with his feathers, and under his wings we will find refuge. His faithful promises are our protection. We will never possess that security apart from the one who loves us the most. And here in this place, the Spirit of God gives us a vision of the one who brings order in the midst of confusion, courage in the midst of weakness, and calm in the midst of life's storms. The story of Stephen gives us a vision of Jesus Christ who lovingly embraces us and draws us to him when our lives spiral out of control. It was this claim that Jesus is standing with God as the Son of Man, full of authority and glory, and finally got Stephen killed, you know. Stephen, who was full of faith and the Holy Spirit, was one of a group of seven chosen to oversee distributing food to poor families. And after the resurrection, the word of God kept spreading quickly in Jerusalem, and even many Jewish priests became part of the community. But that shared ministry to the poor didn't last long. Members of one synagogue were fed up with Stephen's ability to perform wondrous deeds and also speak with such persuasive power. So using false witnesses, they stirred up their own people. And they stirred up the Jewish council, the Sanhedrin, and Stephen was brought in for a hearing before the council. And the first 53 verses of chapter 7 of Acts are filled with Stephen's fiery trash talk at the hearings. He attacked the very history and identity that the Jews had worked so hard to maintain during the Roman occupation. He not only insulted his Jewish contemporaries, he insulted their ancestors. He called them all stiff-necked people, bull-headed hypocrites. They'd sold Joseph into slavery, rejected Moses, turned to idols, persecuted prophets, broken God's law, murdered Jesus, and opposed the Holy Spirit. Wow. Well, how would you feel if someone publicly insulted your family, your ancestors, your history, and your values, your belief system, literally everything that gave meaning to your life? What would you do? Probably react with anger, rage even, which is what the Jewish leaders did. I don't think it was their intention to kill Stephen at first. In fact, Jewish council could not sentence anyone to death. But the council members were filled with rage, and Stephen, whose face looked like that of an angel, was filled with the Holy Spirit. And what incited the leaders from an enraged council to a lynch mob was the threat created by Stephen's witness to their power and their control. When Stephen said that he saw the risen Jesus standing at the right hand of God, well, that was it. That was the last straw. Trash talking's one thing. Even claiming that Jesus was resurrected was not enough to push them over the edge. But when Stephen declared that Jesus was standing with God as the Son of Man, the exalted Lord, the Messiah, that was it. They'd heard enough, and they went out of control, over the very issue of control. The furious riot stampeded Stephen and dragged him out to kill him. Trying to regain their control in the midst of their chaos, Stephen and his disgraceful, blasphemous vision must end. And their stones would put a stop to that profanity forever. Or so they thought. Jesus Christ was still at the right hand of God Almighty. They were not in charge of thy kingdom come. And God would use one of their own, an eyewitness to Stephen's stoning, named Saul, to show the world who really is in control. And remember Saul? Saul would have his own encounter with Jesus on the road to Damascus and go on to be the Apostle Paul, the evangelist of all evangelists. So, back to our Easter question. What are you looking for? Who are you looking for? Today's Easter answers are not about why we should be ready to be martyrs. They're not about Stephen either. Today's Easter answers are less about martyrdom and more about a message of good news in the reign of Jesus Christ. God used the message of Stephen's vision to build the young church. The church is not about the control of priests or kings or even religious councils and even denominations. It is about the power of the risen and reigning Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. That's what the church is about. Because God showed Stephen the vision of Jesus standing at the right hand of God, he was able to suffer and even die with the courage and confidence of Christ's abiding presence with them. And while the stones were flying, Stephen prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Words that echo Jesus' own prayer on the cross. "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Today, God reaches to embrace us into the family of God, where Jesus Christ reigns. Today, as Renee sang to Evie, today God claims you, God helps you, God protects you, and God loves you too. Here within God's people gathered, the risen Christ stands among us and gives us enough faith and courage to face the troubles of our lives, because God gave Stephen a vision of the risen Christ standing at God's right hand. Stephen could use Christ's own prayer to ask God to forgive the sins of his murderers. And because God shows us what forgiveness looks like in the baptismal waters and in the promise of the risen Christ, we can also forgive as we have been forgiven. So what? What are you looking for today? Who are you looking for? You remember Bob, the fellow who started out looking for baby ducks and ended up falling face first on the sidewalk? 2 days later, he was scheduled to serve as a communion steward for the first time. Poor Bob. All he could think of was his ugly mess, his swollen lip and his bruised face and the great big shiner of a black eye that he had. Why did he volunteer to serve at the Lord's table on this Sunday? And what if he offered the cup, speaking the words, "This is the blood of Christ shed for you," and then one by one the people would see his face and reply, "None for me today, thanks. I think I'll pass today. How embarrassing. He might have to move his membership to another church. People will laugh at him and make embarrassing remarks or think he'd been in a fight or even he had been falling down drunk. Those thoughts raced through Bob's mind as the worship service progressed that Sunday. And then Bob heard his pastor's sermon when he said, "Life is not all about you. It's not all about us, even. It's not all about what we look like or what we sound like. It's not about you, whose mortal life is like looking into a dim mirror or like the vapor of our breath that lingers on a glass for a little while and then vanishes. Life is not all about us. Life is all about Jesus. Always. It's about Jesus." "Oh, yeah, I remember now," thought Bob to himself as he began to serve communion to offer Jesus Christ to his sisters and brothers. And you know what? Nobody passed on the cup of communion. What are you looking for today? Who are you looking for? Don't worry if you aren't really certain of anything except the empty space deep inside yourself. Don't be discouraged if you find it hard to stumble your way through confusing and troubling times. Don't be disappointed if it's still hard to find control in your life right now. The good news is that God has already found you and welcomes and embraces you into God's family. The risen Christ gives you faith, the strength, and the courage to continue because Jesus Christ reigns with God forever. Christ is risen. He is risen. Hallelujah. Christ is risen indeed. Amen. Our closing hymn of celebration this morning is "Fairest Lord Jesus." You're welcome to stand as the quartet sings this morning.
Fairest Lord.
Thank you, Evie, for bringing your family for a wonderful day of celebration of your baptism. And thanks to all of you all here in person and all of you who are worshiping with us online. A special thank you to the online worship team. Receive these words of benediction. As we break from these moments of worship and return to the places where we live and work and play, go as God sent Jesus into the world. Take with you the peace of Christ, greater than the peace this world gives, and the Spirit will teach you the truth about God, the one who loves you the most, so that you may know the joy of Christ in all its fullness. Amen. Thank you.